Good evening and welcome to this evening's special event, Architecture, War, and the Erasure of Identity, hosted by Parsons School of Constructed Environments and the Nth Degree Series at the New School. I'm Robert Kirkbride, Dean of Parsons School of Constructed Environments, which includes undergraduate and graduate programs in architecture, interior design, lighting design, and product and industrial design. Across our SCE programs, we explore the many ways that the constructed environment equips us to be and become ourselves through products, furniture, interiors, lighting, buildings, and cities. But the constructed environment does not stop at the tangible world. It is transported intangibly within us, in our minds, in our dreams, in our identities and memories. And this is what we are gathered here tonight to consider in Tim Slade's powerful film, The Destruction of Memory, which has only increased in relevance since its release last spring. Based on Robert Bevan's book, Mr. Slade's film reflects on the current plight of cultural heritage sites worldwide in the face of political and religious antagonism, and it also candidly reveals the deeper roots of the present dilemma. For those of you watching on the live streaming, we're putting the link to the video in the chat window right now, along with the password. Immediately after the film, Emily Moss, director of the BFA Architectural Design and BS in Urban Design, will moderate a conversation with myself, Claudia Valentino, editor-in-chief of Archaeology Magazine, and Tim Slade, director of The Destruction of Memory. To introduce our guests, Claudia Valentino, editor-in-chief of Archaeology since 2010, has been a managing executive and articles editor on a number of award-winning national newsstand publications. A graduate of New York University Magazine Journalism Program, she has taken a general interest approach to science journalism and has served at Popular Science, American Health, and its Seed magazine, which won an American Society of Magazine Editors nominations for general excellence in design during her tenure, in addition to recognition for its web and blog sites. Claudia also writes fiction and literary nonfiction. Tim Slade's films have been screened through North and South America, the UK, Europe, Asia, Australia, and New Zealand on television, at film festivals, and theatrically. He has directed documentaries such as the feature-length Four, which won a gold plaque at the Chicago Hugo Television Awards and was nominated for awards at the Banff World Television Festival, the International Documentary Association Awards, and the Australian Film Institute Awards. Other documentary films include Blank Canvas and Musical Renegades, and the short dramas Every Other Weekend and I Was Robert Mitchum. His films have screened at more than 70 international film festivals. He studied film at the College of Fine Arts, University of New South Wales. Welcome our guests, and let's begin the film.
It's not just about bricks and stones. It's really about some important message. It's the way we see human civilization evolving and developing.
Let's not forget, again, this is a weapon of war. It's killing the identity of others.
How could this happen to monuments that have survived the ravages of the environment, natural disasters? And in this 21st century, we are seeing a willful destruction of these things.
Part of war and conflict has always been the collateral damage. Buildings have fallen in the path of military objectives, but there has always been another war going on.
One of the ways to get rid of history is by remove all the physical traces of that history and make believe that nothing ever happened, nothing was ever there. You can't find any artifacts, you can't find anything, because everything has vanished.
In this war, buildings aren't destroyed because they're in the way of a target. The buildings are the target.
People are people within a place. their history, their identity, how they draw meaning about who they are happens in a place. And what happens to that place matters. Those buildings are part of who they are.
There were grenades, there were killings, there were expulsions everywhere, but I just reacted most profoundly when I heard about the Oriental Institute. Somehow I just put two and two together, I think, for the first time, where I thought, this is not just about somebody expressing their momentary anger and killing other people. This is somebody who knows what is held in that library. They know what they are doing, and they are doing it for a particular purpose. This is not going to go away. They are rewriting history at this very moment.
A century of wave after thunderous wave of destruction. This war against culture is not over. It's been steadily increasing. How can we stem its path and save the story of who we are?
These acts of vandalism are a tragedy for all civilized people. And the civilized world must take a stand.
I think I'll start with a question for Tim, as the filmmaker. The book that inspired you was published in 2007, and I was wondering, when did you begin working on the film? What motivated you? And what do you hope for?
So what motivated me was reading Robert's book and realizing that there was a process that goes on that's not just, you know, the Buddhas of Bamiyan were blown up in 2001 and then several years later something else happens. I mean, it's sort of, I realize that this is a continual process that happens during any conflict, really, and that it's something that hides away a lot of the time in the sort of in the fog of war. So realizing the importance of that issue globally was, you know, it sort of prompted me to want to make something that took what is really an academic book and make it into something that would be more easily accessible for the general public. So it was quite a long process. I mean, the first interview I actually did was down the road at Daniel Liebskin's studio. And then I sort of put it aside. We did other interviews and put it aside for a while. And it was really obviously when the stuff started happening in Syria and Iraq that there was an urgency to finish it and also an interest in the subject matter from people. And what do I hope for? I think that the level of awareness that's been raised, not just by this film, for example, but by through the media, that this is a real problem, has sort of sustained for quite a while now, for the last couple of years or 3 years or so. And so I think that awareness will help. Help with better legislation and better policies and less political obfuscation, which I think will always happen. And obviously this sort of destruction will always happen, but if there are ways to remedy it or ways that people say it's not acceptable, then it will help.
So that... Is this working? Yeah. That actually reference to the media... Claudia, as a writer and as editor-in-chief of Archaeology magazine and a media professional, how do you reconcile truth-telling, truth being a highly contested word in this moment and perhaps in all moments, showing this imagery and perhaps feeding into the intentions of those who are perpetrating the destruction?
Regrettably, I'm not sure how to influence the people who are committing these acts, but that's really what we want. You're right, ultimately. Somehow we want to creep in their direction and hope that by some process, of course, you always have intensely radical core groups, but they're surrounded by other people who perhaps aren't quite as radical as they are, and one would hope that there would be some falling away at some point. That's just, I think, what everyone wishes for. But as far as this film, what I'm so impressed with is that there's always this debate about, and you can see it all the way through the history of the legislation and so on, that how do you reconcile the loss of life with the loss of cultural heritage? Because when lives begin to be lost, that's the first priority automatically. But with the point that the film is making, which I was able to see briefly yesterday and again today, it's the complete integration of the concern. It shows these things completely intermingled and not separable any longer. And as we spoke, I mentioned an incident to you that we had, and you asked me to recount it. When the Erbil is a city very much like Aleppo in that it's considered to be possibly be the longest continually occupied place on the planet. And, you know, evidence about Erbil doesn't necessarily come from archaeological digs at Erbil. There were investigatory digs in 2006. That's what archaeologists do to figure out if they're going to dig a place. And then only about a year or two before 2014 did any kind of archaeological excavation really begin there in earnest. The place has 7 millennia of continual occupation, but it's occupied now. And that's why, as you see in the film, you know, ISIS was 25 miles or so outside the perimeter. And I was up one night, 2 o'clock in the morning, watching CNN, which is a terrible habit. And I happened to see that we had a reporter out there talking about the fact that ISIS was close and that people in Erbil weren't really clear on what to do. And all you could see was just a little sort of street light in the background. Everything was black. The reporter was sort of reporting from the shadows, and there was just on the crawl the word Erbil. And he was talking about the fact that it's currently occupied and that these people's lives were in danger. And I was sitting there saying, you know, as the editor of the magazine, Archaeology, I'm saying, nobody understands what they're sitting on top of. Nobody understands all the occupation that's gone on there. And we were about to run a story 4 months in the future that was supposed to come out in like October, November, mm-hmm. on Erbil, a definitive piece on Erbil. I had it. It was done. And I went into the office first thing in the morning and said, we have to put that piece up immediately. We have to put it up online before it goes in the magazine, and we also have to put it on Facebook. We have now 2 million Facebook fans, the magazine. So we put it out, and I have my little stats with me here, very important to say how we reached people. So it received more than 12,000 likes, 345 comments, and was shared 4,394 times. And that happened even as people were sort of hoping that ISIS wouldn't make their way there. And what was happening in terms of what people were saying on our Facebook page about the piece that we had posted, it was a major piece, like 3,000 words, this issue of integration, people in Erbil were going on their Facebook pages. They were seeing that we had posted the story that we had, and they were just posting, I heart Erbil. My family has been in Erbil for generations. Thank you so much for letting everyone understand what this place is really about. I mean, it sits like a cheesecake. It's that much occupation. You sort of look up at it. It's 7 millennia in one spot. And in terms of memory, no one really knows what's there yet because it hasn't been dug. So we felt that we had the right piece at the right time. We're very fortunate to make the point that it is a matter of integration. These people live there. They've lived there for generations. They know very well what they're sitting on top of. They would probably give their lives to protect it. So there it is. It's intertwined mm-hmm. completely.
Yeah, thank you. That's an amazing story. I want to return to that in a moment, but first, Robert, your own scholarship contemplates the relationship between the constructed environment as an extension of the mind and memory, and even cultural memory. Do we need physical artifacts to sustain culture? And particularly in this age of digital modeling and reproduction.
Absolutely. And I don't want to diminish the significance of the use of whatever tools available to document, preserve, record, and reconstruct the physical evidence of our culture. But at the same time, that digital format is not a substitution. Cognition occurs in a multisensorial manner. It is whole body. Our thinking is not just with our brains, it's through our bodies, it's through our senses. And work that I've done, research, historic research in memory chambers in the Renaissance, for example, revealed through patient examination how embedded in these small rooms that were built in Italy, that the use of onomatopoeia, of the arts of rhetoric, of language, of sound, of smell, of touching the intarsiated wood and feeling where a clavichord is represented illusionistically, that the strings are in metal because you are intended to touch that cool difference of the metal embedded in the wood walls, that is what helps embed your experience in your identity. And that through moving through the space, the composition of those rooms, their design, is conceived with a reciprocity to how we move and how we think through space, through our bodies. And I would also say that when you think closer to home, we can oftentimes just imagine this happening on the other side of the world, with the exception, with a notable, powerful exception of the World Trade Centers here in New York City. Nonetheless, there's a slow and steady erosion that occurs within our own built environment in the United States, oftentimes under the guise of development and progress. And we are in threat of erasing the infrastructure, which is not simply our cultural heritage, but also our mental infrastructure, our identity of who we are. For example, I work with a group, Preservation Works, that looks at a whole series of hospitals for the insane across the United States. And oftentimes, these buildings embody a very conflicted history of a very checkered past in our inability to get our heads around mental illness. And yet, oftentimes, the buildings are seen as scapegoats, and stigmatized communities would rather erase the building as though that will erase the past. And the truth of the matter is, we are no better off 150 years later after these buildings were built, when one quarter of our population, incarcerated population, have severe mental illness and are not receiving adequate care in prisons. And those buildings themselves, one of which was tragically lost in New Jersey in 2015, Greystone Park Asylum, there were multiple groups that were ready to step in and repair that. One group at no cost to the taxpayers, but the personal stigma of local politicians in connection with higher up politicians, including the governor of New Jersey, carried out a fairly clear vendetta against the building. And it was one of the top 10 losses in the United States, and one of the top 5 in the United States, and top 10 in the world in 2015. It was the second largest continuous foundation building in the United States, leading up until the construction of the Pentagon. For 70 years, it was one of the largest buildings in the United States. And I speak of it because the materials that were described, when you destroy the bones of the buildings, you are causing irreparable harm to the culture. And as was described in the asylums, those stones heard the sounds of the call to prayer for 400 years. The buildings that these hospitals and other buildings like them around our nation and other nations were built with original materials, these specifically with many of the trees that had breathed the air for hundreds of years when the country was founded. That's not just about carbon footprint, it's about tangible memory, living memory that is reduced to rubble by being perceived as valueless. So this happens close to home. It happens within our constructed environments around us. And this isn't a call to say that nothing new is good. It just means we have to approach our environment in an integrated manner that looks at the past as part of our future and not antithetical to it.
Do you have any comments to follow up on that, Tim, based on your observations?
I was thinking of something before. I mean, given the audience for the screening and the architectural aspect, when you were talking, Robert, I was remembering, and based on something we were talking about earlier, Emily, going when we went to the Jewish Museum in Berlin, we filmed in there without anyone in the building, before it opened. And so what I found interesting was that moving through that space sort of part by part to document it, the sort of power, the abstract power of architecture, I guess, to communicate, I felt really profound, that it was obviously intentional by Liebskin, but the moving through that gave me the experience of what had happened in the Holocaust, I guess. It's hard to describe, but it was this sort of an abstract way to understand an experience. The building was sort of speaking of this experience that was not in words and much more effective than if they'd written out, you know, between 1933 and blah blah blah. Like I found it really interesting, not as an architect, that how he did that or how architects do that,
right.
You know, sort of communicate these very clear messages but through abstract forms. Anyway, it's sort of related to what you're talking about, Robert. But the power of spaces is really incredible.
I think that's a large part of what we endeavor to do as architects. I wanted to ask if there are questions for anyone.
So I guess I'll address my question to all three of our guests. And is there any way, as citizens of any country, that we can prepare ourselves to limit the damages of destruction to cultural heritage? Or in other words, if we can shield our memory and to prepare for those events from both in our approach to interiors and architecture and also from a purely intellectual and cultural standpoint.
Well, after 9/11, and probably before, but I think particularly after 9/11, most of the American museums worked out much better plans for what they do with their collections if they're under attack. So I know that's talking about movable objects, but there may be, it may be that sort of buildings as well have worked out similar approaches. Obviously, buildings are much more vulnerable to attack.
First I want to give Claudia a chance to respond because I think you've had some thoughts about this.
Okay, thank you. As a journalist and as a magazine editor, I'm not a scientist, I'm not an archaeologist, I'm a general interest magazine editor. And about 25 years ago, I shifted over to science publications because science literacy, I think, is very important. Because if we can get under people's skin and have them understand what heritage is, a site at a time or an artifact at a time, and do it in an entertaining way, it helps and prevents things like defunding of education and defunding of science programs and defunding of grants for archaeological work and for any other type of scientific research. And it's specific to science, of course, what I do, but I believe it has to do with the broader issues of literacy. And one of the things I was happiest about was to see the reference to the destruction of the library, and to see in the film that there were people who risked their safety to go and save the books. So I think that, you know, our culture is dividing itself into people who understand what the value of that is, people who don't, who I think are in a vast minority but powerful, and then there are all these people in between, and I'm after the people in between.
I'll answer on a few different scales. On one level, the group that I mentioned before that I work with, it is not a historic preservation group. It's a cross-section of citizens that includes urban explorers who broke into the buildings and now protect them. It includes paranormalists. It includes a whole cross-section of citizens who care about the buildings in the first place. And therefore, they are starting to galvanize in order to take a stance against developers who otherwise were using the stigma against the hospitals for the insane and the question of insanity to tear them down as an easy sell to local politicians, misrepresenting the facts and the value of the building and the actual cost of tearing those buildings down. But those groups were in isolation from one another and didn't realize the actual cultural value of the buildings that they were in love with. So connecting the dots of those groups has been incredibly powerful and important to share the information and knowledge base to prevent the further damage from being conducted. So the use of social media, we have our meetings, for example, we have our board of trustees is scattered across the United States. We have our meeting on Facebook Messenger. And to communicate and flow that information is one scale, and that can be international, not just nationally or locally. But then I also really appreciated the comment that we can drop in armies to protect buildings, but that makes no sense. It's solved much better through political means and policies. And I think on that end, I would say that seeing that one of the main characters of your film, Irina Bokova, who was just one of the nominees for the Secretary General of the UN this past cycle, and received the second most votes to the male who was elected. I know this is the day after International Women's Day, but I think until we have someone elected Secretary General of the UN who can actually enact and sustain the measures and care deeply and passionately about the matters that we're discussing that you captured in the film. Until we have the people who are brave enough and vocal enough to be in those positions, we are going to find ourselves in this pattern. And I think not reducing it to gender issue, but I do think it's a very important, powerful message that she had to convey. And I think those are the people who need to be in the positions to be able to affect the change that we need around these issues.
Any other questions?
Hi, I guess my question is about the idea of reconstruction, and all three can answer. I come from Beirut, Lebanon, and I saw the reconstruction of the city center after the civil war, and it was basically an act of a capitalist neoliberal development practices by excellence. So I know that a lot of construction companies have been negotiating who's going to take over cities in Syria, and how do you hold these construction companies accountable, because they can be as destructive as the actual people who are destroying these cultural heritage. And then it is at a city scale. It's not at a scale of a monument, like souks are monuments, cities are monuments. And how do you also not only reconstruct a physical object, but also bring in the way people really practice the urban that we've completely lost in Beirut?
Yeah, I mean, what I know, from what I know in terms of Aleppo, that Assad has given out contracts to rebuild the entire city even before the siege ended. So, like, yeah, I mean, this is what these politicians do. He completely pulled the rug out of any sort of considered approach to what happened to Aleppo, which, you know, I mean, as far as I'm concerned, he committed a whole range of criminal acts on the city, and B, can just whitewash all of that because he's given out all of the reconstruction contracts. I mean, I don't have anything positive to say about that, sadly. I don't know the way around that. I mean, I think that politics is always unfortunately getting in the way of these issues, and it will in terms of what happens with Syria, unless enough people sort of resist those collusions between powerful countries.
There's a category of archaeology called rescue archaeology, and that's archaeology where a team goes in when construction is imminent. They go in ahead of construction, and they rapidly dig a site. They pull everything out, and they categorize it, and they take it out of there. And then back in the labs and so on, then they figure out what they have. That's the thing to push for there. Rescue archaeology goes on all around the world. It's a very robust category of work. And I think that there's no way, there's so much money involved in the kind of thing you're talking about that I don't think it's possible to stop it. But one thing would be to demand rescue archaeology on all those sites, because you'd be surprised what can be saved. I mean, there's artifacts from the bombings in Germany. One of the oldest Neolithic artifacts called Lion Man. He's 35,000 years old. I think he's a doll, or maybe he's a female doll of a lion. He was found, pieces of him are still being found, little splinters of wood, even though he was sort of caught up, he was unearthed during the bombings in World War II. So it's not a waste of time to press for rescue archaeology there.
And after aside from the reconstruction done by local politics or the rescue, you have an option of recognizing that you can. You have the ability, as András Riedelmeier had said, I've seen him say this elsewhere, and I'm just trying to paraphrase it simply, that there are some rescue attempts in some nations with UN, you have the rescuers who go in from the United Nations, from other groups, UNESCO, etc., into endangered sites or destroyed sites. And oftentimes, the experts who are dropped in or flown in have their own views and their own cultural approaches and industries they are trying to bring to the ground. And sometimes those introduce further problems into the localized condition, because there's an industry of destruction and catastrophe response, and that's defined along national boundaries too. Some countries, it's an industry for those countries to actually go into imperiled areas and to bring their culture and their technology and products into the area. And at the same time, I don't want to disrespect that, but at the same time, it makes it a broader, more complicated problem of how you're solving the problem by introducing even further voices that are problematic. So.
Thank you. Are there, sorry, Other.
Sure, I can try to talk loudly. Speaking of barriers, so there was a moment in the film about the.
In the discussions around the Geneva Convention in 48, when it spoke about the US and Canada and some other countries opposing this cultural genocide category because of their own complicity, I think that's right, their own checkered past. And it occurs to me that that might still be a barrier, and that this argument of lives over culture allows countries that engaged in colonial practices of genocide to keep the moral high ground. So with that power dynamic in play, you know, are we really gonna, I don't know, what progress can be made?
Yeah, I mean, I would say that, yeah, the term cultural genocide was also removed from the Declaration of the Rights of Indigenous Peoples in, I think, 2007. So, yeah, so nothing, I think the only way would be to have caveats that we're not gonna look retrospectively. You know, I think otherwise countries that were big colonial powers like Britain and others will, you know, if there's any leeway to have a raft of sort of claims made that go back into the past, I think, you know. I think though that idea of cultural genocide may appear in other future documents that are quite specific. Obviously... Yeah, the problem with all of them is that people have to agree on the terminology and the language, and so there's that. There's also the possibility that cultural genocide could be read broadly in the convention if it is seen to have a serious psychological impact on people. I was talking to a genocide scholar the other day her perspective is that's maybe the way, because rape wasn't included in the convention, but since the Bosnian War, the word rape isn't included in the convention, but it's been read to include rape used as a weapon of war. So there's maybe a way to more broadly read the convention and include those acts as under a sort of psychological trauma level. So... anyway, there's clever ways to get around the resistance of, you know, caused by the long shadow of colonialism, I think.
I have a question about what you think the role of a university is in trying to be a voice in this debate or discussion. I mean, the destruction of identity is also, of course, the destruction of history. So when giant Buddhas are destroyed or bridges are destroyed, it's an erasure of history, which is, you know, in some ways equally, of course, profound and disturbing.
Yeah.
What is the role of a journalist, a filmmaker, as a coalition effort? What do you see as possible advocacy beyond obviously very interesting and wonderful individual projects?
Yeah.
Is there a role to play with all these lawmakers, some of whom are more receptive than others?
I think given your question of what is the role of the university, of academia, of journalism, of movie making, filmmaking, etc. It has to be a coalition. That's why we're sitting here. That's actually why we have the people gathered here to talk about this and why we see the value of being here and why we're in this, using the university to actually convey this issue to an audience that is broader. It's interesting because that's not a given history, it's a challenging history, because you saw some of the consultants, some of the interviewees from University of Pennsylvania Archaeology Museum, for example, which is an incredible collection that I had the fortune to spend a lot of time at as a student at University of Pennsylvania, and spent a lot of time growing up looking at that collection, and it's fantastic that we have that, and yet that has part of that checkered past of colonialism, which is part of it as well. Those collections were created as part of Some would say plundering, others would say carefully editing and extricating, and others would say preserving aspects that might otherwise have been lost or still be there. So that has its own problematic point of it is served to educate many and to inform audiences across the world, but it has a very difficult history of its own in how it presents that material and to whom. So now, I think, certainly being here at the New School, where we have very focused attention on social issues of social migration, immigration, memory. We have a memory center that focuses on these issues, the Zolberg Center. We have a deep connection to these issues that are social, psychological, and physical, architectural, urban issues. And we have to use ourselves as a venue to explore and embrace this very, very challenging, difficult past, because it's not going to go away. We can only perpetuate and exaggerate that the difficulties of the past by ignoring it or pretending we can erase it.
As the editor of the magazine, Archaeology, it's owned by the Archaeological Institute of America, which is over 100 years old. But the magazine is editorially independent. They don't tell us what to cover or how to cover it. That said, we are covering the discipline of archaeology through the lens of journalism. So journalism keeps us on the high road. You know, journalism keeps us honest, if you will. That said, we're very interested in the evolution of the discipline of archaeology as well, and you know, as someone at a distance, you know, from it, but who observes it carefully, I can say everything that everyone says about museums and so on and how they came by their collections is the case. But the thing is, that whole community knows it now. They know it. And archaeologists know it too. So whereas 50 years ago, an archaeologist might go out into the desert southwest and dig up an entire chief in his regalia and then bring him to a museum for study where he sits for 50 years and no one ever looks at him, that can't happen now. That just won't happen anymore. And there has been enormous amounts of repatriation, so of those remains to the proper tribes. So I think we're in this situation where we have these, you know, parallel tracks of activity where there's the past, and the past has to be accounted for, and people have to figure out what to do about it. But then there's also the future, which is where everybody's headed to with a more highly developed sense of ethics about everything, because these things are being exposed, because journalists are writing about them, and also because the academy is examining these things constantly on the ground. And for example, we're sitting here. And also, I know a number of the people in your film, and I know that for every one of the people who's interviewed in your film, that's them sitting in a chair talking to you. I can tell you that out from these people is concentric circles of massive amounts of activity. Each one of them is involved in this pretty much 24/7. So the hour and a half represents who knows how many man hours on the part of each of them and who they're connected to. There's a lot of people on this, really, in terms of saving heritage. So that's sort of like, you're like the bouillon cubes, you know. Just add water to his film and then you'll get the idea of how much is going on.
Yeah. I think on that note, we will end, and you're invited to come and have a glass of wine with us in this room, and I hope that we could continue to talk in a more personal way. Thank you.